Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, Part 6, Hell Cop and Highway to Hell, and the upcoming fan film Vengeance, where I'll be playing Elias Voorhees. That's right, Daddy Knows Best, Jason. Hey, I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.
Final Destination, Death of the Senses, Chapter 3.
Now you're absolutely sure that you're okay?
Bereave asked. Ah, Pete, Amy protested, though she was still somewhat pleased at being fussed over. I'm totally fine, okay? I just need to get rid of this headache and I'll be ready to come back to work. Once I have that damn checkup, anyway. She sipped her coffee and looked around the squad room to see if any more well-wishers were going to come over. It finally seemed as though the entire precinct had spoken to her.
You still got it? Don't you got any painkillers?
I gave them to that guy Jack. Bereave shot her a suspicious look.
What guy?
You know, Jack Curtis. Bereave leaned back in his chair and made a face.
That guy. You know, I didn't trust that bum from the moment I saw him. There's something about him that just sets off my alarm bells up here.
He tapped on his forehead. Yeah, Amy said. Helping somebody out like that, the bastard.
I'm not kidding,
Bereave said, looking offended at not being taken seriously.
You know he's got a record.
Yeah, for what?
Dunno. Cohen wouldn't tell me, but I think I might try and find out.
Amy sighed. Jeez, Pete, give it a rest, okay? The poor guy's already homeless. His life's bad enough as it is without you harassing him.
I'm not gonna harass him, Bereave protested. I'm just gonna keep an eye on him, that's all. He knows more than he was letting on. Maybe the dead guy was his buddy and, Curtis got cold feet while they were waiting around in the alley.
Duh, that'd be 6 inches of snow giving him the cold feet, Amy sniffed. Tiring of Bereave's paranoia. For a moment, she thought about telling him why Jack had come running back along the street, about his vision story, but decided not to. For one thing, she'd promised Jack she'd keep his secret. For another, she didn't want to hand Bereave another reason to keep him under close scrutiny.
Hey, enough with the sarcasm. I'm just watching out for you here, said Bereave.
Yeah, I know, I'm sorry. Amy finished her coffee and flicked the empty cup into a trash can. Just don't get, you know, bent all out of shape about Jack, okay? I really, really don't think there's any reason to go all KGB on him. One of Bereave's bushy eyebrows twitched.
Since when are you on first name terms with the guy?
Didn't I tell you? Amy smiled. We got engaged this morning. She watched Bereave's reaction. God, you should have seen your face just then. Relax, Pete. You're the only man in my life right now.
And ain't I the lucky guy?
Bereave smiled and he stood up.
You still want to ride home?
Amy rose and checked her watch. Yeah, thanks. Oh, we'll need to take a detour on the way. I need to find a pharmacy. Get some more painkillers.
Well, if you keep giving them to every sad-ass hard luck case that comes along...
Every sad-ass hard-luck case that saves my life, Amy reminded him. Come on, let's get moving. Despite the cold, Jack's mood continued to improve as he made his way across town. The sun was shining, the wind had dropped, and he would actually have somewhere to stay for the night. He'd even decided to use one of his precious dollars to treat himself to a hot dog from a street vendor. It wasn't his usual fare, but what the hell? After last night, he deserved to celebrate, in however small and silly a way. It also helped him keep his mind off the memory of the man dying. The image crystallized in the flash of light as the gun fired, a red, wet hole bursting open in his face, smashed teeth suddenly exposed under the dim yellow glow of the lamp. He shook his head, trying to will the thought away. If he hadn't done it, both he and the policewoman, Amy, would be dead now. However horrible the sight had been, he'd done the right thing. He'd saved her. Not like... He shook his head again, this time angrily. The sudden blur, the flash of red. No, that was another time, another place. A completely different situation. He didn't want to think about it. In one way, he realized as an odd thought struck him, some good had come of it. If the accident hadn't happened, he wouldn't have been in New York to save Amy's life in the first place. There was a strange twist of fate. Cold water spattering off his shoulder jolted him out of his reverie. He flinched and ducked away from it. The sunlight on his side of the street was causing the ice and snow on the windowsills and ledges above to melt. No doubt it would refreeze as soon as the sun moved around and dropped them back into shadow. But he had had enough problems without getting wet into the bargain. Being in the sun was a pleasant change, though. Should he stay on his side and take the chance of being dripped on by trickles of freezing water and lumps of ice, or cross over into the shade? The hell with it, he thought. He was going to make the most of the winter sun, although crossing the street would be easy enough. The traffic, he noticed, had come to a standstill. Irate horns honked around him. Ahead, he could see the flashing lights of a police car. No, two of them, and a crowd gathering blocking the street. What was going on?
Oh, shit, what's going on here?
Bereave craned his neck, trying to see over the knot of traffic that had ground to a halt in front of them. Amy followed his gaze. She knew the traffic patterns for this part of the city quite well, and this wasn't normal for this time of day. Something was happening further along the street. As if on cue, the radio came to life.
A leaper? Said Bereave, listening to the report. Christ, no wonder everyone stopped. Damn rubberneckers will be waiting for him to jump.
They weren't far from the scene.
We'd better go and help out, I guess, Amy said.
I'd better go, Bereave corrected. You're off duty, remember?
Come on, Pete, said Amy. What am I supposed to do, sit in the car until they bring him down?
Bereave considered it for a moment.
Okay, come on, just do me a favor. Don't try to catch him, will you?
Brad might be a sarcastic little bastard, Chelsea thought, but he was certainly a good driver. They hadn't even had to break any traffic laws to get here. Well, maybe a few had been bent, but it was Brad's license on the line, not hers. He parked the truck on the sidewalk as close as they were able to get to the scene before the traffic came to a complete standstill. Chelsea left the technician to extend the transmitter tower and establish an uplink to the station, while she and Brad jogged along the street to the scene. The cops had stopped the traffic and tried to keep the inevitable crowd back, but there was still quite a crush. She took in the scene, trying to work out the best angles as she searched the skyline for the leaper. There he was. The building was a nondescript dark brick tenement block, probably from the 20s, and the potential suicide was out on the edge of the roof, standing on a narrow ornamental ledge above the top row of windows with his back against the parapet.
Do you see him? She asked Brad.
Yeah, I got him. Brad was already readying his camera.
See anyone else on the story? Chelsea scanned the street for the telltale mast of any other news trucks. None were in sight.
Nope. Looks like we're first here.
Great. She reached the edge of the crowd, Brad pushing ahead of Chelsea to clear her way, while she switched on the charm to mollify anybody who objected to being shoved aside. Excuse us, please, coming through. Hi there, she said with a sultry smile when recognition flashed across somebody's face next to her. A handful of cops were trying to keep the crowd back, hurrying back and forth in a rough semicircle in front of the tenement, waving and yelling as people tried to push forward for a better look. One of them tried to wave Brad back, but stopped when Chelsea moved around him and treated him to her best how you doing look. She'd already unfastened her coat so that she could show off her legs, which, as always for work, were shown off to their best advantage by stilettos and sheer pantyhose, and was gratified when the cop, mid-30s, tending to overweight, even though he'd probably went to the gym 3 times a week, hair thinning,
gave them a superstitious but clearly approving glance.
"Sorry, ma'am, you'll have to move back," said the cop.
"Hi," Chelsea said brightly, ignoring his request. She nudged Brad to bring up his camera as she switched on her microphone, thrusting it toward the cop's face. "Chelsea Cox, WNYK News. Can you tell me what's going on, officer?"
Phillips, the cop answered, briefly looking down to check out Chelsea's legs again.
"Officer Phillips, hi. On three, two, Officer Phillips," she said, shifting quickly into all business mode, and she could tell from his unsettled expression, catching the cop completely unawares. "Can you tell me what the situation is?"
We received a call that there was a man on the roof," said Phillips, something of a rabbit in headlights look on his face as his attention flicked awkwardly between Chelsea and the unblinking gaze of the camera, not sure which to address. "When we responded, we found what seems to be a homeless man in a state of some agitation on the roof. When we tried to get close to him, he climbed out onto the ledge and threatened to jump unless we backed off."
"And has he given a reason for wanting to jump?" Chelsea pressed.
She glanced up to make sure the leaper was still there. Missing the fall while she was talking to some dim-bulb cop wouldn't do at all. The tiny figure was still right where he was supposed to be, out on the ledge.
I don't know. There's a couple of guys up on the roof trying to talk him down right now."
"Officer Phillips, thank you. And clear. Keep rolling, though," she told Brad as she looked around. "Over there!" She pointed to the opposite side of the street, where a flight of stone steps led up from the sidewalk into a building. "What do you think?"
"Good spot," said Brad. "I can get a decent angle on the roof and the landing zone from over there."
"Great. Officer Phillips," she said silkily, turning back to the cop, "could you give us a little help?"
"I don't know. I..."
She flashed him a smile of the kind that she'd bet he'd never seen since getting married.
Sure, I guess."
Jack crossed the road and walked past a parked TV truck, its transmitter mast stretching into the sky like a mechanical giraffe, and joined the crowd. Everyone was looking up, so he followed suit and saw what they were gawping at, a man standing precariously on a ledge just below the edge of the roof, at least 12 stories up. Ghouls, he thought. Some poor bastard had reached the end of his tether, wanting to end it all, and people were gathering for the spectacle. He could even hear laughter from somewhere in the crowd, discussions of exactly what effect such a fall would have on a human body. Sickos. He picked his way through the crowd, continuing along the street. A short way ahead, he saw a TV cameraman and a very attractive blonde woman hurry up a flight of steps. The man turned to point his camera back over the heads of the crowd, while the woman took up position in front of the lens, one hand brushing at her hair. She looked familiar. It took Jack a moment to remember where he'd seen her before. She was the reporter who had been covering the fire the night before. Great. More exciting death for her morbid viewers. All of a sudden, she looked a lot less attractive to Jack. He shrugged and continued walking, looking over at the cops, trying to keep the crowd under control.
"Hey, wasn't that... Jack!"
Amy spotted a familiar bearded face moving through the crowd along the sidewalk opposite the Leapers building. Bereave had left her at the edge of the crowd while he joined the other cops, trying to move the crowd back.
"Jack! Hey!"
"Damn it! I'm getting wet!" Brad complained, pulling a baseball cap out of a pocket and putting it on.
Water was trickling down from above and splashing over the top of the steps. Too much to be simply snow melting on a window ledge.
"Must be a burst pipe up there or something."
He cautiously tipped his head, trying to look up without getting water in his face.
"Lot of ice up there. Oh, shit!"
He raised the brim of his cap for a better look.
"There's a load of phone cables up there. They might block the shot."
"Never mind that," said Chelsea, quickly checking her makeup in the mirror of her compact.
She had to admit she looked great. She wasn't sure about the lighting, though.
"Do I need a key light, Brad?"
"What?"
Brad ran his hand over the top of the camera, which was spotted with water from the drips above. It was rainproof to a certain extent, but he didn't want to run the risk of a short.
"Do I need a key light? I don't want to just be a big dark silhouette."
You won't be, Brad assured her impatiently, looking through the viewfinder. The sun's off to the side.
It's behind me, Chelsea snapped, moving her hand back and forth in front of her face to make her point. Look, see? Shadows! I need a key light.
Brad grunted and ripped open one of the Velcro-sealed pockets of his jacket, fumbling inside before pulling out a spotlight, which he slid into place in a slot on top of the camera's casing. He flicked a switch to turn it on, illuminating Chelsea's face.
This'll eat up the batteries, you know.
Whatever, give me the monitor. I want to see how I look.
Brad sighed and took a 5-inch LCD monitor from another pocket, plugging it into a socket on the camera's side and handing it to her.
Happy now?
Hold on. Chelsea put a hand over the monitor to shade it, then peered intently at the image on the screen.
The lighting wasn't perfect, but it would do. And she was quite well framed. If the guy jumped while she was talking to the camera, he would land right next to her eyeline.
It'll do.
She put the monitor down on top of the wall of the steps.
The important thing is, do I look fuckable?
Brad muttered something under his breath.
What?
I said I'd fuck you.
In your dreams,
Chelsea replied, knowing full well that there'd been no I'd in Brad's comments. Arrogant little bastard. Well, she'd see how arrogant he was after being reassigned to the skateboarding duck unit.
Light look okay?
They'll be able to see every gory detail, Brad assured her.
She turned her attention to the monitor.
Can you zoom in on Jumpy McSplatto up there?
What are you doing here? Amy asked.
I was on my way over to the shelter, said Jack, overhearing the reporter's Jumpy McSplatto comment and frowning up at her. What about you?
Pete was driving me home. We got stuck in the traffic. She shielded her eyes and looked up at the roof at the building opposite. God, I hope he doesn't jump. Doesn't matter how much they think they want to die, they always scream on the way down.
You've seen these before?
Just the once, Amy said, with a slight involuntary shudder. Once too many.
Jack was about to ask her how the police went about trying to talk potential leapers down when he caught a sudden movement in the corner of his eye. He whirled to face the building behind him and saw a momentary reflection of something falling in the window next to the steps. For one awful moment, he thought the man had jumped, a chill of fear running through him, but when he turned back, there was no sign of anything. The crowd was still buzzing with anticipation rather than gasping in shock, and when he looked up, he could still see the tiny, frightened shape of the man on the ledge.
Jack? Amy asked. What's the matter?
I don't know. He looked back at the window. Nothing. I just thought I saw something falling.
Amy looked up at the building behind them. Icicles were hanging down from windowsills and phone lines.
Probably just ice or something?
Probably, said Jack, unconvinced.
Amy regarded him quizzically.
Unless you think it was another vision.
Jack shook his head, wanting to dismiss the idea as quickly as he could.
No, you're right. It was probably just a lump of ice. Although, when he looked back at the window again, there didn't seem to be anything reflected in it. Not even the street opposite.
The reporter on the steps caught his attention. She was holding a small monitor, one hand over it to shade it from the sun, the image bright enough for him to see. The cameraman was aiming his camera up at the sky. And on the screen, growing larger as the picture zoomed in, was the leaper. Jack started to get an odd, uneasy feeling as details of the clothes became clear. And then the man's face.
Oh my God!
What?
Amy asked, turning to see what had caught his eye.
I know him.
Hey!
Jack shoved past the couple of people in his way and hurried up the steps.
Let me see that.
Hey!
Yelped Chelsea, glaring in disdain at the obviously homeless man who had just appeared next to her, trying to look at her monitor.
The hell do you think you're doing?
Amy followed Jack up the steps.
It's okay, no trouble.
Like hell there isn't.
Chelsea looked at Brad, who had pointed the camera back at her.
What the fuck are you grinning at? Stop filming and get rid of this guy.
I'm a police officer, Amy said, raising her voice, and he's with me.
Chelsea sneered, but calmed down.
Jack, what is it? The cameraman had switched his attention back to the man on the roof. It's Lonnie. I know him.
You know him? Chelsea purred, instantly changing her dismissive expression to one of keen interest and signaling Brad to start recording again. Sir, can I get your name?
What? Asked Jack, looking up from the monitor at her confused.
Your name, please?
Jack Curtis. Jesus, I knew he was kind of depressed when he left me last night, but I had no idea he was this bad.
Mr. Curtis, can you tell us anything about the man on the roof?
Jack looked back at the little monitor and realized that he was on camera.
What? No, stop filming.
He waved his hand in front of the camera, then turned to Amy.
Look, I know him. I might be able to talk to him. Can you get me up there?
I don't know. I can try. Come on.
She took Jack's arm and led him through the crowd. Brad's cell phone vibrated, the cameraman whipping it from his pocket and snapping it open with his free hand before the first buzz had even stopped.
Yo, yeah, cool.
He closed the phone again and put in his earpiece.
Uplink's ready.
About time, Chelsea said, connecting her own earpiece and switching it on.
She winced at a momentary buzz, then heard George's voice coming from the studio.
George, can you hear me?
I got you, Chelsea. How's the situation?
Nothing yet. The guy's still on the roof. But listen, there's a guy here, Jack Curtis, either homeless or really, really into the grunge look, says he knows the jumper. There's a cop with him. They're going to try and talk him down.
You get a shot of him?
Of course, Chelsea snorted.
Great. Be worth staying with him. He might turn out to be a hero or end up tipping the guy off the edge. Either way, he's worth talking to. You didn't piss him off, did you?
Who? Me?
What in the hell's he doing here?
Bereave demanded, stopping over to join Amy and Jack at the front of the crowd.
He was on his way to a shelter. Listen, Pete, said Amy, talking quickly and occasionally flicking her eyes up to make sure the leaper was still on the roof. Jack says he knows the guy up there. Says his name's Lonnie. He's homeless and last night was depressed and was talking about killing himself.
Well, a 13-story drop on the pavement's one way to do that, said Bereave. So what?
I might be able to talk him down, Jack said.
Bereave regarded him suspiciously.
We got two guys up there trying to do that already. They're getting nowhere. Every time they get close, he leans out and threatens to jump until they back off. The guy sounds crazy.
They don't know him, insisted Jack.
I do. He's not crazy. He's just reached his breaking point. Look, at least give me a chance. Even if he doesn't want to talk to me, it'll still keep him occupied for a few minutes so you can, I don't know, put out a net or whatever you do.
Bereave laughed.
A net? We're not the damn circus.
He looked up at the figure hanging off the side of the roof.
If this guy jumps, slips, whatever, his time's up. There's no way on God's earth to stop it.
He rubbed his mustache, thinking.
But,
with clear reluctance, he nodded at Jack.
Okay, I'll take you up there. You got one try to talk him back off that ledge.
Jack looked up at Lonnie again.
That's all I ask.
Okay then, let's go.
They set off for the door of the building, Bereave stopping after a few steps and turning to Amy.
Where do you think you're going?
With you,
Amy said, confused.
You know the guy up on the roof?
No.
You on duty?
No, but...
Then sorry, Amy, but you gotta stay down here.
What?
Hey, Phillips, Bereave called. Keep an eye on Amy for me, will ya?
Pete!
Hey, Amy, said Phillips, ambling over.
How you doing? I heard you got hit on the head last night.
I'm doing just fine, Amy grumbled, watching in annoyance as Bereave and Jack disappeared inside the tenement. She tilted her head back to look at the roof again. The man, Lonnie, was thankfully still up there, but Bereave was right. If he fell, there wouldn't be any way to save him.
Well, that's the development, Chelsea commented as the two men, Curtis and a beefy cop with a rather ugly mustache, entered the building. Will you be able to see him when he gets onto the roof?
Depends on how far he leans over, Brad said, zooming in on the roof again.
Chelsea leaned down to look at the monitor.
Well, let's hope he's a really close friend and tries to grab him. Where's his cop girlfriend?
Brad turned his camera back onto the crowd. Talking to that cop you flashed your legs at?
See if we can wave her back over. She might be able to give us some background.
She's kind of cute, too.
Cute? Spat Chelsea. Leave the cute for kittens and puppies.
She checked her makeup again, then turned back to watch the rooftop.
Thirteen stories up, Manhattan was noticeably quieter than down on the street. Jack could still hear car horns below, but the constant rumble of street noise had faded, giving them an odd, distant quality. Just as Bereave had said, there were two other cops on the roof on the tenement building, but they were keeping well back from the edge, standing near the entrance to the stairs. Looking past them, Jack could see Lonnie, or at least his top half, his back to them. His lower body was hidden behind the parapet.
"Hey, Pete, who's this?"
asked one of the cops with a dubious look at Jack as he and Bereave walked over to join them.
"Reckons he knows our guy over there," Bereave told them.
Jack wasn't the least bit surprised that he didn't bother to tell the cops his name or mention the small fact that he was also the person who'd saved his partner's life the night before.
"Thinks he might be able to talk him down. What's he like at the moment?"
"Seems to have quietened down at the moment," said the cop. "Problem is, every time we try to get close, he sets off again."
"What kind of things has he been saying?"
Bereave said.
"Yeah, like, what has he said?" Jack asked.
Both cops looked at him as if waiting for Bereave's permission before deigning to reply. Bereave nodded slightly.
"Crying, mostly," said the second cop, speaking for the first time. "Lots of stuff about how he can't take any more, how he's got nothing to live for. Not very coherent. It usually turns into a screaming rant after a minute or so. I don't think he really cares whether we can make out what he's saying or not. He just wants to get it off his chest."
Bereave regarded Lonnie for a long moment.
"You think he's serious about jumping, or he just wants attention?"
"Hard to tell," said the first cop. "There's been a few times when he's let go of the roof completely. Puff of wind is all it'd take to send him over."
"Good thing it's not windy, I guess," Bereave said, still watching Lonnie. "Okay then, Curtis. See if you can get through to him."
Jack took a deep breath, then walked slowly across the roof. Amy wasn't quite sure how she'd got suckered into it, but she was now standing on the edge of the top step with a microphone jammed into her face and telling that over-made-up harpy Chelsea Cox everything she knew about Jack. Whatever the blonde's power of persuasion was based on, she was very adept at it.
"A real-life hero despite being homeless," gushed Chelsea, turning to face the camera, and at the same time subtly moving across to push Amy towards the edge of the frame, "who follows up saving the life of a police officer one day by attempting to talk to a potential suicide victim down from a roof of a tall building the very next. An inspiration to us all. We'll bring you more on this story as it develops. This is Chelsea Cox for WNYK News."
She gave the camera her trademark sign-off look, a hint of a pout, and a suggestive narrowing of the eyes as she tipped her head slightly, held the pose for a few moments, then clicked her fingers. "And clear. George, did you get that?"
"Got it," said George through her earpiece.
"Think you might use it?"
"We could drop it in as a breaking story during the next commercial break, if the guy's still up on the roof, that is."
"Yeah, I know it's not much, but you can cut in some footage of the leaper as well."
Chelsea turned and blinked in surprise as she realized Amy was still standing next to her.
"Oh, sorry. We're done now. Thank you."
She turned back to Brad.
Oh.
Amy felt oddly disappointed at being dismissed so suddenly, and even a little embarrassed about the fact that she was still standing there like a dummy. A sudden change in the noise from the crowd made her turn.
"Hey, he's moving,"
said Brad, quickly aiming the camera skyward.
"Get back! Get back! I warned you! Don't come any closer! I'll jump! I'll do it! I'll really do it!"
"Lonnie," Jack called cautiously.
"Lonnie, it's me!"
Lonnie stopped twitching, peering warily back over his shoulder.
"Jack?" he asked in a slightly less agitated voice.
Yeah, it's me.
What do you want? Jack took another couple of careful steps, then came to a stop about 6 feet from the ice-covered parapet. His hands held up to show Lonnie he wasn't trying to grab him.
I was kind of hoping to get you back onto this roof.
Don't waste your time, Jack, said Lonnie, starting to twitch again. I told you last night, I just can't take any more of this. I just can't.
His voice trailed off and he closed his eyes, slowly lowering his head. Jack thought he saw the head of a tear grow in the corner of his eye.
I went to the shelter last night after I left you, Jack. It was full. So I went to another one. It was full, too. And another, and another. You know where I slept last night, Jack?
He opened his eyes again, the tear breaking free and rushing down his cheek.
A kennel. A goddamn kennel. I slept inside a busted-up old doghouse that somebody had put out with the garbage.
His voice cracked as he started to shake, sobbing.
I had to sleep somewhere that people didn't even think was fit for an animal.
Lonnie, said Jack, very carefully moving a step closer to him. Listen to me. I know things are pretty bad, but that's no reason to just give up. There's always a chance. There's always hope.
No, you're wrong, Lonnie said, taking one hand off the edge of the parapet to wipe his eyes.
Jack winced, freezing in place.
There's no point. This is it, Jack. This is the bottom. There's no one else. No one else I can get help from. Nowhere else I can go.
Except up.
You really believe that? Lonnie asked, looking over his shoulder at Jack again. Look at me. Look at what I've turned into, what I'm doing right now. There is no chance. There is no hope. Not for me, anyway. If all that I've got to look forward to for the rest of my life is more of the same shit,
he suddenly yelled the word,
that I've had for the last few years, then what's the fucking point?
He looked away, staring out across the city. Jack took the opportunity to move another small step closer to him.
I can see him, Brad suddenly announced.
Chelsea and Amy both looked at the monitor. Even at the sharp angle from which they were looking up at the roof, Jack's head was now visible above its edge. That meant he must only be a couple of feet from Lonnie, Amy realized.
Keep the camera on him, Chelsea ordered. George, you watching this?
I'm not even blinking, the reply crackled through her earpiece.
Ready to go live if we need to?
My finger's on the button.
Jack could see enough of the street below to give him a slight feeling of vertigo. He had no idea whether Lonnie was prone to it or not, but he was close enough to see that even in the cold, his friend was sweating.
Look, Lonnie, a cop told me something this morning, he said, trying to keep his voice as level as possible. She said that even if people really do mean to kill themselves by jumping, they always scream on the way down, Lonnie. The second they do it, they regret it.
Lonnie said nothing, but Jack could tell by his expression that he was listening.
It's no way to go out, Jack continued. Screaming in terror because you realize you just made the worst mistake of your life, and there's nothing you can do to change it.
He hoped he wasn't overdoing it, but he was running out of options.
I've made other mistakes, Lonnie sobbed,
but there's still a chance you might be able to do something to fix them. I mean, come on, look at how much you helped me. I wouldn't have survived my first couple months on the streets if I hadn't met you. If you hadn't told me how to keep going, Lonnie, please, let me help you.
He made a deliberate move forward, only one step away from being able to reach out and touch Lonnie, or grab him.
Jesus, he's almost there, said Brad, barely breathing.
Chelsea put down the monitor and moved back in front of the camera. Whatever happened, it was going to take place in the next few seconds, and she wanted to be ready.
Get back on the roof, Jack begged.
What about them? Lonnie asked, shooting a look in the direction of the cops. What'll they do to me?
I don't know. They'll probably arrest you, but...
He quickly continued, seeing fear across Lonnie's face.
Believe me, a night in a cell's not so bad. I was in one last night.
What did you do?
Lonnie asked through his tears.
I'll tell you, if you get back on the roof, here.
He held out his hands. Amy tensed, one hand to her mouth. She didn't have to watch the monitor to see Jack reaching out for Lonnie. Slowly, shakily, Lonnie took one hand off the parapet and reached back over it.
his trembling fingers touching Jack's. Jack closed his grip, the two men looking at each other for a moment. Lonnie managed to smile for the first time in days.
"He's got him!" Brad gasped.
Chelsea frowned. A leaper being talked down from a roof, as opposed to jumping from it, was a third or fourth story, at best.
"Okay, Lonnie," said Jack. "Now really slowly, really carefully turn around. I've got you. Just turn around and let me pull you back up." From nowhere, a cold wind sprang up. It wasn't like a normal wind, Jack thought. A continuous force of moving air. This somehow felt more like a snake circling around them, looking for the place to strike. Lonnie shifted slightly as the wind hit him. One foot on the ledge, the other raised just above it as he prepared to turn around. Ice cracked under his toes. Lonnie's foot shot out from the ledge, his unsupported weight instantly dragging Jack forward and slamming him hard against the unforgiving brick of the parapet. Pain ripped across his chest, but he still had Lonnie's hand.
"Whoa!" Chelsea gasped, even anticipating the fall hadn't prepared her for it. But the man wasn't falling, not just yet.
"Help me!" Jack screamed over his shoulder at the cops, as Lonnie kicked and thrashed in panic on the other side of the parapet. "Help!"
He could hear them charging across the roof, but he couldn't keep his grip. Lonnie's fingers were slipping. Amy made an indistinct sound of horror somewhere deep in her throat as the struggling man broke free of Jack's grip and plummeted downwards with terrifying speed, his coat caught by the wind and flapping open like wings, wings that would never fly.
"Shit!"
exclaimed Chelsea involuntarily, not caring if she was now on a live feed. She watched him drop, ripping past the windows, behind him. Whatever happened, however messy things were, she had to be ready to turn to camera and deliver her report.
"No!"
Jack yelled, the cops crashing against the parapet against him, just a fraction of a second too late. Amy watched, unable to look away, as Lonnie fell and started to scream. 9 floors up. 8, 7, 6. Lonnie's flapping coat snagged on one of the phone wires stretching across the street. It should have either torn under his weight or simply slid off as he fell past. It didn't. It wrapped around the cable not once but twice. Impossible or not, it held Lonnie. Lonnie was jolted to an abrupt, rib-breaking halt, just 2 stories above the ground. Tracking Lonnie's fall, Brad was caught by surprise when the plunging figure suddenly stopped, continuing to tilt the camera all the way down to the ground before he realized something had happened. Reacting on cameraman's instinct, he snapped the zoom lens in to cover as wide an area as possible, Chelsea flashing into view as the picture pulled back. The guy was caught on something at the top of the frame. Lonnie's coat finally ripped and he started to fall again. Chelsea snapped her head around to look into the camera in amazement.
"Did you get that?" she gasped.
The phone wire, freed of the sudden weight that had pulled it down, cracked like a whip, a wave motion rushing along its length toward the other side of the street. Lonnie hit the ground, injured, but still alive. Amy barely had enough time to register what had just happened when something passed above her. A strange serpentine movement. The phone line! The wave reached the end of the phone wire where it connected to the building, where Amy, Brad, and Chelsea were standing on the steps. Ice had built up on the wall from a leaking pipe, growing one freezing drip at a time to spread like tentacles along the half-dozen lines running into the building. Hanging down below the cold mass were long pointed icicles, melted and refrozen together over days, into top-heavy masses with claw-like points. The wave hit the heavy ice. Part of the motion was sent back along the wire. The rest was transmitted into the ice as a vibration. The ice shattered with a sound like breaking glass. Chelsea instinctively looked up at the unexpected noise directly above her. It was the last thing she ever did. A chunk of ice, 2 huge icicles melted together, with foot-long tips sharp as daggers, hit her in the face. The jagged spikes plunged right through both of her eyes in a wet spray of ruptured eyeball and spurting blood and brain matter. The sheer weight of the ice rammed the tips of the icicles right through the back of her skull before the shock of the impact sheared most of the frozen mass away. It crashed to the ground between Brad and Chelsea's still-standing corpse and exploded into jagged fragments. Amy turned when she heard the noise, just in time to see the back of Chelsea's head burst open in a slurry of red and gray. The body somehow stayed balanced for a moment, hands twitching, before its knees slowly buckled and it toppled backwards down the steps, long shards of ice still protruding from its gushing eye sockets. Somebody behind Amy shrieked. She would have done so herself if she'd been able to catch her breath. A voice was yelling in Brad's ear. It took him some time to work out that it was George back at the studio, frantically telling him that they were still alive and asking him what had happened. The face in his viewfinder wasn't Chelsea's, but the young Asian cop's they'd just interviewed, staring at him in horror. Had what he'd just seen through his camera been real? He cautiously pulled his head back from the viewfinder and looked down. It had been real. Did you get that? He asked of nobody in particular, right before throwing up. Okay, this has been the action-packed Chapter 3 of Final Destination, Death of the Senses. I gotta say, I'm pleasantly surprised at this being a Final Destination book, and that was a pretty damn gory ending of that chapter. I don't think anybody's gonna be shedding any tears over Chelsea being the first one to officially bite the dust victim-wise when it comes to death. But I want to know what you guys thought of the book so far, what you thought of tonight's chapter, and what your expectations are moving forward. Why was Chelsea the victim? It really seemed like Lonnie was going to be the one to bite the dust, and then bam, Chelsea goes out. And what a way to go, too. Icicles through the eyes. Yeah. Guys, I'll be back very soon with more of Final Destination, Death of the Senses. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, and here's another little fuck-up for you to laugh at. I'll see you next time. He tapped at his forehead. Oh boy, forehead.
I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? We kill the flame.